Hey, so I'm in Bulgaria. I'm actually in Sofia, and it's a nice city. And I think that I've sort of discovered another sort of epiphany, mainly that, you know, the primary issue governments are now dealing with isn't just financial and technology. It's where to put the tax revenues in a way that creates sustainable cities. Now, on the way here, before I came here, I was expecting a lot of Soviet-era buildings, like this one. You know, very, you know, non-ostentatious, very utilitarian. And they are here. And the Soviets, when they built something, it was made to last. You know, a lot of the stuff that they still built, whether it's a train station, a train, a tram, it still works. An escalator of a massive size, it still functions even today. And so that was actually the idea behind the Soviet Union, was not only gender equality, you know, and stamping out corruption that they thought was part of the capitalistic framework, which ironically they've been proven right today. But the idea really was to create a situation where the working class took over the essentially city planning, finance, and all these other things that are now required to make a city function. And so you can see it is a beautiful place. I'm here in October and it's just, look at these trees. But if you don't take a walk down a side street, we're not gonna see this. I mean, you're not gonna see these Soviet buildings. On the way here from the airport, I was telling myself, I don't understand. I was expecting a lot more of these buildings and I can't see any of them. I see all I see is modern buildings. So I thought to myself, this is fantastic. Sofia has come a long way in 15 years, and it has. But the way that it's gotten here is unsustainable. And it also explains the rise of real estate tycoons, not just Donald Trump, but anybody, everywhere. And it's not just, you know, you look at a situation where the whole world has now become prisoner to the Las Vegas development model, which is essentially you've got a lot of land in one place. There's almost nothing there, or it has to be demolished in order to create something pretty. So what you do is you try to figure out, you know, just like governments, when they get the revenue, what they did was they figured out, well, we're gonna have to pay these people off, whether it's a union, whether it's, I mean, any interest group, the police, whoever is controlling the strings, the last election year, that's who we pay off, and then we worry about city planning. What that attitude has done, even though it has created jobs, and I shouldn't say created jobs, it's maintained jobs. And it's the strategy that you use if you're trying to avoid a recession. But what that attitude has done, what that approach has done, is that it's created a situation where, rather than try to compete with the mafia, the absence of a robust city planning effort on a national level, unlike Singapore, which obviously has a city planning national effort, what that has happened, and that approach, is that it's created a situation where private actors, whether criminal or non-criminal, are able to come in and occupy the gap that the legitimate players, like the government, which is supposed to be a legitimate player, has essentially allowed to be, has essentially vacated. So, when you think about it, you know, you sort of do live in a world where the bad guys are the good guys and the good guys are the bad guys. And in many cases, you're sort of cheering for the bad guys. One reason that that's become intuitively acceptable is because the good guys have simply, they're failing. And over here, whether it's here or in Albania or any Eastern European city, the way that the Europeans have fought against this intrusion into the what is supposed to be the legitimate scope of government jurisdiction, which is city planning, they've simply co-opted the mafia. They've co-opted the criminals. The criminals make a lot of money. They got to put their money somewhere. They prefer real estate. And they prefer it for a lot of reasons, right? One, you can touch it. The government doesn't mind. They can tax it. That's another reason gambling is so popular. And ultimately, what you see here is governments allowing a few players to buy up entire blocks. So, you know, before, on the way here, I passed by two gambling establishments. A lot of them seem like they make their money on sports betting within one block of each other. So you can look at that, and it's not just here, it's in Albania, and I imagine any generic Eastern European city where the EU is trying to flex its muscles and get rid of all these sort of small businesses that are not compatible with its, you know, with its vision of what a future city is supposed to look like. And so you create a situation, if you try it in this way, you create a situation where you have a lot of interesting places, a lot of places that look good, but only on the main streets. Because whoever you are, when you buy a piece of property, you know, you're not gonna wanna fix up all these sidewalks. The government, you know, like I said, it's focused its attention on jobs. You know, you've got a tram over here, right behind me. A lot of European cities have those small ones. And this is the police station here. And see if you can see it. Yep, there you go. And so, what's really interesting is that these are beautiful cities. And I'm trying to think of, you know, a way to fix these cities, to improve them, but without increasing segregation, because right now the attitude is, this is not a bad attitude, you know, this is not a bad approach, because these sidewalks are not fixed, because people who live here, they're still safe, they're next to a police station, because it's cheaper, what ends up happening is that you can still have these small shops that a lot of people rely on. You know, not everyone's gonna go to college, not everyone's gonna get a union job. So this lack of development in certain areas, a lot of it is it's not necessarily by design, but it's accepted and considered to be acceptable because it maintains a character within these cities. But more importantly, it allows that shopkeeper not to have her rent raised. So you see why segregation has been an implicit assumption of any development model. In the United States, because of slavery, because it was one of the last countries to abolish it, you've got this dovetailing between segregation and race, which still exists today, which is why everything you do has long-term consequences. And like I said, it's really interesting. You have so much uneven development. This is a brand new building here. Look, sidewalks all busted up. So the problem really, if you haven't figured it out by now, is that doing development in this model, in this way, ultimately creates a situation where the infrastructure stays the same, but you have a lot of nice, pretty buildings. You can call it the Las Vegas model, you can call it the Dubai model. But regardless, I mean, that building, by the way, is next to this. So it probably should be taken down, but so again, a lot of these questions come up. You know, what do we do to create a model that works? China obviously is trying to copy Singapore, but it's not gonna work. Singapore works because it's small. It can fix things immediately if it makes a mistake. So everyone's trying to figure out the best way. I should probably head back over here, across the street. But you know, the other issue is, you know, when I was in Egypt, the second issue, I apologize for jumping around, is that when you do development in this way, you create a situation where not only do you have segregation and inequality, because you've got vast sort of growth rates, you know, that compete with each other. This side of the train tracks grows a lot more slowly. Rents stay down, but so do prices and wages. And then on the other side of the train tracks, things go much, much faster. The reason for that is because you are trying to buy up blocks of land so that you develop the entire place in a way that's consistent. In the other place I was just in, it's a little bit tricky here. We gotta be a little bit careful here. So the other issue here is that, you know, when you buy up those two, not casinos, they're just gambling establishments. What ends up happening is you put shopping malls in between them, small ones, and you know they're not legitimate businesses. You know they're just places where rich people can park their cash, whether it's illicit or legal, because the stores in there make no sense. It's like somebody opened up a mall to give their grandmother or a friend's grandmother a job somewhere so she would have something to do once the kids moved out. And nobody's buying anything. It's just a lot of these products are knockoffs. So you get to see to sort of recognize these things after you've seen them many times. But the problem with that, again, the government likes it because you've got one real estate owner that it can negotiate with, that it can tax. The mafia likes it because it's got something tangible, and it can create, you know, a place to put their money. And of course, construction is a way to do it because it's got so many places to hide money. Cement, you can fudge numbers easily. You buy something, you just add another zero to the end of it. So getting back to what I was saying before about Egypt, you go to Egypt, there's a neighborhood called Manshea. It would be considered a ghetto. I wouldn't call it that. But you know, you can see that you've got the UAE spending about $6 billion, but most of it's going to Cairo. And you've got Alexandria in this, you know, and within this Manshea network, this neighborhood, you can't build a shopping mall because you would have to destroy everything. The city planning for that neighborhood was designed for horses and walking. So it is a nice place to walk. It's got a park. It actually, from a city planning perspective, is a better model, despite being old and not suitable for cars. It is a better model than what we see today in most mall-driven cities. That is a little bit scary, just because you can imagine that the reason that we are in this current situation is because we just don't have a lot of creativity. And so you've got this merging between legitimate businessmen and women and legitimate and illegitimate players and actors. And this is the result, because you only develop one side and you're hoping at some point to get over to this side. It doesn't work that way, because in some places you literally cannot develop it at all without destroying the entire neighborhood. The cost of repairing these places, of refurbishing these buildings, a lot of them are quite old, is prohibitive. This is where the government is supposed to, nonprofits, they're supposed to step in and fix this. They're not doing it. They're focusing on social issues. And this is clearly, look at this. So this is, we're in the Soviet era, in the Soviet side. So this is great. You have an open space. You got one little playground there. It's cute though. You know, people can walk, they can bring their kids. They have a place to go. You don't really get that if you build a mall and a bunch of parking spaces. And so you've got a situation where, because the government and the real estate tycoons have merged operations, they don't call it that, but that's why you see a lot of people who are billionaires making their way up the chain in politics. They've merged operations, and now there's a lot of debt involved, trillions of dollars. And ultimately, that debt has to be paid. The question is, how do you do it while maintaining this model? And I don't think it's sustainable. And that's problematic. In order to fix this entire, well, I don't know about fixing it, but in order to fix it, I mean, like I said, this is not a bad neighborhood. We are in the capital city, by the way. I haven't been to a smaller city, so I can't imagine what it's like to, you know, sort of update and upgrade a smaller city. But this is a nice place. And ultimately, what we're looking at when you look at development is that no one's got the answers, because everyone is trying to copy each other. I saw the same architectural design in Kazakhstan as I did in Reno, Nevada. Two worlds apart, the exact same design. I guess people figure if you visit one place, you won't visit the other, so you won't make the connection. But my point in pointing that out is that you've got a number of very small players with the same architectural firms, with the same cement companies, with the same concrete buyers, and ultimately it all ends up in a shopping mall somewhere. And the question is, how do we move away from that and back into a system where the Soviets were not correct, where they were in a position where, you know, when they talked about creating a model that was different from the corrupt capitalistic model, what were they thinking of, and how do you create a balance between these two systems? Because if we don't get that balance right, there's a good chance that we're going to have not a revolution necessarily, not war, but just a total failure to develop human potential. And what all this is all about, whether it's economics or city planning or education, is that the kid who's born here on the wrong side of the tracks has the exact same opportunity to succeed as the kid who's born next to a brand new establishment or next to a brand new condo. And education is supposed to make that better. It hasn't. I don't think anybody's arguing that education has been the answer. And so the question is, how do you overcome that? Smaller cities have an advantage. You know, Singapore proved that. Liechtenstein, a lot of places prove that. But that model cannot work for places like this, where you cannot sort of subsume the local flavor, the local character into a shopping mall district, because it's just not meant to be that way. And the question is, how do you create development in a way that doesn't lead to a universe that's controlled by people like Donald Trump, or people that are just focused on business and paying off debt and gaining debt to create their own model of development that is supposed to compete fairly with other models, but clearly doesn't really do that, because once you control billions of dollars of development, you probably have a way of controlling the supply chain in ways that block out competitors. And once again, that's what the idea of government is, to compete with these private actors, to have a balance. And in many countries in the West, especially, by not corralling technology, you know, you've really allowed a situation where, you know, Facebook is legitimately a major technology company, is legitimately talking about creating a currency to compete with the government. So you see a total sort of supplanting of, you know, functions that were once considered exclusively in the domain of nonprofits and governments for the public good. You're seeing all of that move over to the private sector. And a lot of that, the root cause of almost all of that, is this merging between the city development, the merging between the private actors and the non-private actors, the public actors, but in ways that don't necessarily maximize human potential. And we're all trying to figure it out. But the problem is, the more we let the status quo continue, you know, this debt keeps piling up and it has to be paid back. That's one reason the Soviet Union collapsed, is because they couldn't compete with the financial system of the West. It wasn't that they had an inferior system, it's just they didn't quite get the banking system correct, or the insurance system. It's very complicated. But at some point, if it doesn't maximize whatever system you have, if it doesn't maximize human potential, it's just another pyramid scheme. To the extent that the banks and the military are driving some sort of development that they believe is superior or sustainable, but in fact is not. So here we are. You know, it's like New Orleans. I love New Orleans. You go to the French Quarter, one of the nicest places in the whole world. But the minute you leave that quarter, you go out, take the train or the tram, small tram, leave it, and there's nothing there but shopping malls and big boxes, big box stores. Same thing in many neighborhoods in Texas, highways and all that. Of course, that goes back to oil. And you really start to see that this is not the way to go. This is not the way to maximize human potential. And it's always been that way. We've never gotten the answer right to human potential, no matter how much money we've spent on it, which should tell you that money isn't necessarily the answer. It may be the opposite. It may be the opposite approach. If you have too much money, you can just keep going, and nobody will stop you. And certainly politics today in the West has sort of proven that. So I'm going to keep traveling, and I'm going to try to figure out how to fix all this. But unfortunately, I'm not blue collar. I don't know how to build a house. And so I may have reached the limits of my ability to figure things out on the city planning level, which, of course, because it all goes back to city planning, I'm not sure if I'll be able to sort of figure out a new model of human development that sort of competes properly and balances out private and the public sectors.